That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
It's July 20, 1969. And the world stands still as it watches history unfold on their TV sets. The broadcast of Apollo 11's landing on the moon.
This night, something like 125 million Americans and uncounted millions in other countries saw a unique combining of romance and technology.
Among the 650 million people watching is a six-year-old boy in Osaka, Japan, Hideo Kojima, whose passion to become an astronaut would bloom there and then, as he considered them to be the heroes above any other. For the next few decades, Hideo would immerse himself in anything he could get his hands on to do with space. Science journals, magazines, and even science fiction novels. While Hideo himself would never set off into space, his fascination with science and technology would influence his work as a video game designer. His masterworks, the Metal Gear Collection, a series of games showcasing his unique blend of adult themes and childlike imagination, bridged by his passion for science fiction. These were stories featuring giant robots, vampires, and ninjas that rubbed shoulders with more complex themes like family, loyalty, and betrayal. But what would end up at the heart of Hideo's cinematic science fiction series was a value passed down from his father, clear anti-war and anti-nuclear values.
And as for the anti-nuclear messages that are found in my games, this actually goes back to my parents, because my parents were born in the 1930s and, you know, they experienced the air raids on Tokyo. So when I went into the game industry and I started making my own games, I really wanted to carry over this message of anti-war, anti-nuclear proliferation.
But this anti-war value wouldn't be the only thing Hideo would inherit. In the Metal Gear document simply titled Shedding, Kojima discusses the contradiction that existed in his father, who, when he was a child, was up on the roof watching bombs fall during air raids, still had a passion to join the Navy. And in later years, Hideo recalls being made to sing military songs in the bathroom. This dichotomy between the disgust for war and desire for a war hero would not only torment his father, but also Hideo himself, who would go on to embed a sense of guilt into his series as he attempts to settle his contradictory feelings about war that he also inherited. In the book titled Metal Gear Solid Naked, Kojima discusses the impact of his father's death on his storytelling. My father died when I was in the 8th grade, so I haven't gotten over my father complex. So all the games I've finished so far have been about paternity. They're simply games about killing one's father. But in the loneliness of the now empty house would be where Kojima would read his books and watch his movies and develop a special knack for historical detail. Alongside his personal search for peace, this passion for history would end up being a primary point of difference between the stories told by others and his own. While others were turning to future realities to tell their science fiction stories, Hideo would go the other direction and set his stories in the present, while calling on details from real-world history to enrich his story worlds. The result of this is a science fiction series so entwined with factual detail that the lines between both become blurred, to the point where official books have been published dedicated to unweaving the truth from the fiction. But of all the installments across the series, the one that captures both Kojima's passion for history and his inherited burden regarding war is Metal Gear Solid Snake Eater, a story set in 1964, smack bang in the middle of the Cold War and 5 years before the Apollo 11 landing. For Kojima, history is only a guideline. As we're about to see, Hideo has a knack for redesigning factual details in order to invent his own version of reality, a mythology living in the shadows of history.
Flying over Pakistan, altitude 30,000 feet.
A good example can be found in Snake Eater's opening scene where the protagonist, a CIA operative called Snake, begins his mission by halo jumping out of an aircraft and into a fictional jungle near central Russia. The aircraft being used in this opening scene is modeled after the MC-130 Combat Talon, an aircraft specially designed by the US Air Force for special missions such as this. But the MC-130, at this point in time during 1964, hadn't been deployed yet, as according to the history books, this Combat Talon would only be officially deployed 2 years later in 1966. In the Metal Gear Solid book simply titled R, Kojima explains that he circumvented this historical inaccuracy by adding zeros to the aircraft, showcasing that this particular aircraft was an experimental prototype. It's cheeky, But these kinds of historical rewrites can be found around every turn across the series. But while a lot of them, like this one about the combat Talon, only exist to strengthen the peripheral world building around the characters, Kojima's fanciest footwork revolves around the characters themselves. For example, most of Snake's mission is centered around the extraction of the fictional Sokolov, a Russian scientist who defected to the US. In Kojima's mythology, Sokolov was the scientist responsible for the Vostok 1, which was a real space capsule that launched Soviet astronaut Yuri Gagarin into orbit on April 12, 1961, making him the first human to complete a full orbit around the Earth. After the Vostok event, Sokolov defected to the US after becoming afraid of his own nuclear creations. But a week after successfully making his way over the Berlin Wall and into American custody, the Cuban Missile Crisis took place. In the history books, the nuclear standoff was ended thanks to a deal struck between the two sides. The Soviet Union would agree to remove their weapons from Cuba only if the US agreed to remove their weapons from Turkey. But in order to tell his own story, Kojima would redesign this part of history as well.
The Turkey deal was a ruse, a cover story that was fed to the other intelligence agencies around the world.
So what did the Russians really want?
Sokolov. They wanted us to return Sokolov.
After agreeing to the terms, the US handed Sokolov back to the Soviets, where he was forced to work on more nuclear weapons, but as it turns out, would be abducted by another faction.
Freeze!
After finding Sokolov in an abandoned shack, Snake is ambushed by the KGB, who in turn is ambushed by members of GRU, led by one of the Spetsnaz, the gunslinging Major Ocelot.
So this is the legendary boss.
Huh? You! You're from the Ocelot unit of Spetsnaz.
Huh.
What's a GRU soldier doing here?
That's Major Ocelot to you.
I wanted to ask you about Ocelot. He can't be any older than 18 or 19. I can't believe he's already a major.
All I heard was that his mother was supposedly shot in the gut during battle, and that he was born right there with bullets whizzing past them. They say that when they stitched her up, the scar was shaped like a snake.
Now, while the Ocelot unit is a work of fiction, the Spetsnaz is the real deal and acts as the special forces wing of the GRU, who were formed before the KGB as the Soviet Union's independent foreign intelligence agency. But this entire scenario is one of Kojima's deeper cuts, because he not only calls upon the historically accurate rivalry between the GRU and the KGB, but also combines a second conflict regarding a plot to overthrow the current leader of the Soviet Union, Nikita Khrushchev, which ended with the next in line, Brezhnev, becoming the new leader.
Sokolov was being guarded by the KGB and hunted by GRU? Snake, it sounds like this could be even hotter than Cuba.
In the Snake Eater story, Kojima harnesses this moment in history and pits Khrushchev and the KGB against Brezhnev and the GRU to create a whole new layer of conflict to Snake's mission. In Kojima's mythology, this anti-government faction is led by the fictional Volgin, a GRU colonel whose trigger-happy impulses would lead him to fire a nuke on one of their own R&D bureaus. The fallout of this would be the US having to prove their innocence in this catastrophe by executing the leader of their special forces, the one known as the Boss, who by no coincidence is Snake's old mentor and parental figure.
I didn't raise you and shape you into the man you are today, just so we could face each other in battle.
This is where the story has all been leading towards. And sure enough, like most of Kojima's games, the mission ends with Snake killing the boss. An evil necessity required for completing the mission. In this moment alone, Hideo's own internal dichotomy is put on display, as the only way to be rid of war was to destroy the war hero themselves. But another layer exists between these two characters. While they would ultimately be repelled from each other because of nuclear war, in the beginning they were brought together by the very same thing. The backstory of these two characters, while ultimately fictional, borrows from the most tragic parts of the Cold War, as they are both characters linked by nuclear radiation poisoning. 10 years earlier, in 1954, Snake would find himself involved in the nuclear experiments on Bikini Atoll. On March 1st in the history books, the US government would set off the Bravo shot, a nuclear bomb whose radius would exceed predictions by over 2.5 times, which led to radioactive contamination in the surrounding areas. It would later be revealed that Snake would suffer sterility because of radiation poisoning.
Snake, you were an atomic test subject, weren't you? On Bikini Atoll. That's part of the reason I was drawn to you. You and I are alike.
As for designing the boss's backstory, Kojima calls upon his love for space travel.
Look at this scar. This is proof that I was once a mother.
After giving birth in the middle of the battlefield in 1944, the boss would suffer radiation poisoning during the nuclear tests in Nevada in 1951. This would ultimately lead her to being part of Project Mercury, the US's first human spaceflight program. While the Soviets were indeed the first to send a man into space, Kojima would let the US win in his mythology, as the boss, being chosen because of her previous exposure to radiation, would take a secret flight into space in 1960, becoming the first astronaut to orbit the Earth. A hero above any other. Like Kojima and his father, both Snake and the boss were brought together through the poisons of war. But in the end, Snake executes the boss, and the poison is purged. By harnessing details from real-world history, Kojima successfully designs a new mythology, but interestingly, would go on to weaponize it, using it as a tool to punish the son.
I killed her, my beloved, with my own hands.
Snake, you can't keep attacking yourself for things that happened in the past.
It's your fault! They're dead because of you!
In a cruel twist of irony, Snake would end up adopting his own war hero mantle, and it would grow to become its own venom. He would end up living a life drowned in guilt, hating war, but hating even more the glorification of his own war legend.
You're a legend in the eyes of those who live on the battlefield.
It's an honor to speak to a living legend like yourself.
It's an affliction felt by both the creator and the creation, the father and the son. So in the end, it's unclear if Hideo was ever able to shed his father's burden by redesigning history and destroying the war hero, but perhaps a clue lies in the ending. During the credits of Snake Eater, Star Sailor's Way to Fall plays in the background, a letter from father to son. I've got something in my throat. I need to be alone while I suffer.